get Heather. She up in the front. The flower.
Let's send it together, okay?
I might invite everyone in church to please stand and turn towards the rear baptismal font. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the waters of sacred and holy baptism, Mr. Clarence A. Nash died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with Jesus eternal glory. lift up Clarence to the Father in heaven, worship and adore his creator and savior, Jesus Christ. We honor his beautiful life. We love all his children. This Catholic journey by those Mass brothers and sisters began in Our Lady of Prompt Support when they were little bitty infants down in Louisiana. And that Catholic journey continued here at St. Anne, St. Philip Neri, St. Simon, St. Reed, and now St. Elizabeth. It's like the entire journey of faith, and that's represented in that Easter candle. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, whose nature is always to forgive and show mercy, we humbly implore for your servant Clarence, whom you've called to journey to you, since he hoped to believe in you, grant that he may be led to our true homeland, to the light and its everlasting joys, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading.
Thank you. nothing else along with him, who will bring charges against God's chosen ones. It is God who acquits us, who will condemn. It is Christ Jesus who died, rather was raised, and who also is the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of God? Will anguish, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or the sword? No, in all these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor municipalities, nor present things, nor future things, nor power, or height, or depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Before I begin today with a word on the Word of God, I want to say a special word to Clarence's family, especially his three children, Clarence Jr., to Heather, and to Anthony. You know in the Bible, number three is the perfect number, right? Jesus rose on the third day. God is Father, Son, Holy Spirit in one. So your dad had the perfect number of children. He had three. And he loved you all, and he put in each of you that Nash humility, which is just so very beautiful in you. My heart and the prayers of the church go out to you. He, like the Nash family, is very loving. And you knew you were loved, and you loved him. And so where we want to go today is we want to hold your hand and walk with you to the Lord, because guess what? He's the only one that can save us. And if we don't know Jesus Christ, this moment is just filled with tears that won't stop. But if we do know Jesus Christ, we are lifted up and filled with a hope beyond all hope. And that's what the Word will give us today, to lift us up. If God is for us, St. Paul says, who could be against us? But I bet everybody in this church has had somebody who is against you at some time. What is the Lord really saying? His word is true. If God is for us, who can be against us? Meaning, if God is for us and we know that, nothing else matters. The circumstances of life can be hard, they can be scary, they can be frustrating, and sometimes people don't always have our back, but God always does. And when we know him and we are loved by him, like the Nash family, we know that the only thing that can separate us from God is sin, and even Jesus died for that. That's why that scripture makes us feel a certain type of way. Heather, you are a favorite daughter. And as we met the other day to plan this, when you read, if God is for us, like you like got up a little bit out of the pew. Family, that's what humility and faith does. We allow God to touch us. But those that stay in the things that keep us from God, we can stay in that place of anger or bitterness or whatever it is, and we don't feel God lifting us up. And that's one of the hallmarks of this beautiful family. So isn't it beautiful? There may be a lot of things in any given day or week that feel like they're coming at us, and it certainly feels like they're not on our side. God's on our side, and he's behind us and before us and above us and under us. We know that God is for us. Nothing will separate us from that greatness. And then our own sin can be repented and placed at the feet of Jesus, who will forgive any sin that we are truly sorry for and we want to be free from. And it is such a great gift to know the blood of the Lamb showering us and making us clean and ready for glory all over again. You know, when I met him, it was probably 8 years ago, he was visiting his younger brother, who had just gotten a terminal diagnosis of cancer. And so we were sitting, Bertram and I were sitting together in prayer. Rosalind was there. We were ready to pray and celebrate the sacraments. And your dad walked in the door. And he looked at his baby brother. And you can tell that when you see your younger brother very sick, you're the older brother, it just does something. And I looked at him, and I hadn't met him before, and I said, we're about to pray. Would you like to pray with us? You know what he said? That's what we do. They were solid. They're like bricks, right? Didn't that solidness didn't begin with their amazing gift bricklaying. Their solidness began in their home, in their baptism, in their raising up in faith. And that's why the Nashman had that gentleman quality, that solid quality, and that goodness about them. They were gentlemen and gentlemen, but and strong and faith-filled. And so in that place when we anointed, which was at that time Bertram's last anointing, we didn't know his last Holy Communion that he was able to really receive, and his brother was right there. And it was God who, what did the scripture say in the gospel? Visited his people. That's what makes us strong. We try sometimes to be humanly strong, and it's not to say that we don't have that quality, but at the end of the day, we don't have strength like God has, nor should we try to have it. We let him be the strength in our life, and then signs, wonders, and miracles open up. We can really live a life of faith that gives us great things. The gospel. Oh my gosh, this is the perfect gospel for today. So, Jesus, the Son of God, the Son of Man, he comes into the city of Nain and finds out that a woman who was a widow had just lost her only son. And what does he do in faith? He brings that son back to life. He raises the dead. There's a double thing. There is a foretaste here of what Jesus, God's only son, will do on Easter. He will raise himself from the dead and give that promise to those who believe one day. But there's also a compassion here. Something missing greatly in the world. Sometimes missing in gatherings of people. But it's something that the brothers Nash, the family Nash, was given when they were very young. Don't live for yourself. Live for God and others. Pay attention to somebody else's pain or need. Now think about this. Listen to this verse. As Jesus drew near to the gate of the city, a man who had died was being carried out in a coffin by pallbearers, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. That not only was an amazing miracle of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, Jesus, in his perfect humanity, saw himself in his mom. Mary, by this time, was a widow. Joseph, who had been older, was deceased. And Jesus was her only son. Empathy. Being able to place yourself into somebody else's pain and allow the Spirit to not make you pity, but to feel compassion. That's what he said, your compassion. And you see that our pain can be shared. Isn't that powerful? So this gospel chosen by Heather is a foretaste of what God did and will do to conquer sin and death and the experience of death in our own bodies. But also it shows us that on any given day, Jesus, who had so much to do, didn't miss it. And that's something about those Nash brothers I've always admired. Even when they're ill, they're still trying to look out for other people. They had that quality of noticing. And I don't know about you, but the world we live in seems to be getting more selfish by the day. You know what that means, believers? We get more like Christ by the day. Because when the bar keeps getting lower, we keep raising the bar. If the church doesn't do that, who will? And that's something, my brothers and sisters, that I just am so touched with. In this family, Jesus has a word for the future, for all of you, for him. But Jesus right now is in your pain right here. Right here, like you saw his mom as a widow and a mother of an only son. One day, her husband would be gone and her baby would be crucified for our salvation. And he saw this and did this miracle as a foretaste and as an act of great God love. So I tell you, arise. And here's the final piece I want to leave everybody with today. Because as Christians, if we forget this, our grief doesn't have what St. Paul says we need to have. St. Paul says there's two types of grieving. one with hope and one without hope. Grieving with hope means we believe. Grieving without hope means we don't. Grief without hope means everything looks dark and black and there's nothing, because there's nothing beyond life, right? If you don't believe in God. But grieving with hope means Jesus, this is to be absent from the body, is to be present with the Lord. His life is actually just beginning. It's just kicking off. And so at a Catholic funeral, the placement of the body is done exactly the way the word says to be ready in the way Jesus is coming. In a Catholic church, the altar always faces east. Why? Jesus ascended to the Father from the east, and he said, keep your eyes on the east, because one day I'm coming back the same direction I left. So at a funeral, a Catholic funeral, the body is always feet first. Why? He's ready to face these. So if Jesus returns while we're here in church and raises up his body, he's facing the direction he needs to be. And that, my family and friends, is the hope that I have and I hope you grow in this time. Because if we don't know Jesus, it's time to get to know him. It really is. Because we have today, we don't know about tomorrow. And we all know that in the last week, the world became just a little more unsafe. And then what a great time to get to know Jesus better and to live in him, to raise the bar, so that while we're here, we can experience the grace and faith in our calling, and then live ready to wake up one day when we arise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Church of God, please rise. As we offer our prayers and petitions this very day to our Heavenly Father, I invite you to respond to each prayer as a community. Lord, hear our prayer. In baptism, as an infant, Clarence Anthony was baptized in Our Lady of Pompe-Sauveur in Louisiana. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. For this we pray to the Lord. Our brother was nourished and came to the table of the Savior, the Holy Eucharist. Welcome him now into the halls of the heavenly banquet. For this we pray to the Lord. We pray for the world we live in. We pray for peace. We pray for an end to terrorism and injustice. When we pray that the Heavenly Father continues to purify, strengthen, and raise up the church to be the light of Christ on this earth, for this we pray to the Lord. We'd like to pray especially for the family and friends of this dear man. They seek comfort and consolation, heal their pain, and dispel the darkness and doubt that can come from grief. For this we pray to the Lord. Father God, we are assembled in this church in faith and confidence to pray for our brother and to strengthen our hope that we live this expectation of Jesus' second coming. For this we pray to the Lord. Father, giver of peace and healer of the soul, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who speak. Grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this in Christ our Lord, and the church's response is amen. Please be seated as the altar is prepared.
There
mercy, that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge, lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is to be right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. Jesus is the salvation of the world, the light of the human race, the resurrection of the dead. Through him, the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exalted praise as we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory."
Until you come again, we
consolation, giving thanks that you held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church will spread throughout the world, bring to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Mitchell, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant, Clarence Anthony Nash, Sr., whom you called from this world unto yourself. Grant that he who is united with your Son, Jesus, in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, and with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. We praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Are Catholic and receiving, when you come forward and put your hands up, we ask that body of Christ.
Thank you.
time, we have 15 minutes. Heather said there were several members of the family who'd like to say a word. So you may speak in the pulpit. Just be careful. There is a marble step up to the pulpit, and it's easy to forget it's there when you're finished speaking. So try to remember that when you come down, because it's easy to miss that step. So for those who would like to say something, we have about 15 minutes. Make a line over there, and anyone that's right to you.
Thank you, fathers. I guess I can have all of them in his mouths. Get y'all men together. Excuse me. I'm Baron Wilson, and if you look at the end of the obituary, I'll come in where it say a host of nephews and nieces and other friends. That's me. Well, love you, Tony Nash. Triple D, Tony. My boy, little brother, you remember me? In hell. Now, I had plenty of days when Uncle Clarence, if it weren't for the Nash family, I wouldn't be who I am today. The brick God. And Father, Stephen gonna get them steps done out there too. I said, I'm gonna leave your business card so we can point them stamps too. So let me get on. I know I got 15 minutes, long minute. But every morning that I get up, I got a picture on my wall. It's nice Peter Claver, 317. And all of them on the picture. I'm talking about my father, Theodore Wilson, Mr. Nash, Bertrand Nash, Clarence. Honeyman, Mr. Logan, Mr. Malachi, Mr. Pinson. I mean, these dudes was like pillars to my life. And I'm not gonna forget about you, Mr. Coffin. I think you're the only one that I can touch. I ride by your house with Geraldine every day. So believe me, if I see fire, I'm coming to put it out over there. So you're not by yourself. And back to Clarence, we was doing this house out here. I came in Bear Creek or something out on 44, and it's hot days. And come on, boy. You know how I'm clearing. Come on, boy. He always call you boy. You don't know. You know your name, but boy is everybody's name. And so we're going home. I fall off those golf, and I wake up, and Uncle Clarence sleeping. He driving. I mean, thank God I'm here right now. But I ain't gonna be before you long. I just want to say that I really appreciate the time that Uncle Clarence has spent with me, Amber, Raymond, all them, because it's like, one day we sit on the porch, and I was trying to understand how you be at work. And he running through me, this is what you do, your time, this time, this your time, this to add this, and then if that ain't enough money, you put another zero on. I got that part, but I just couldn't get the time for it, how you get the money. So he left me alone, and then he said to me, when does a baby walk? Or when it walk? And now I'm walking. I just want to say to the Nash family, I love you. And I'm here. And I want to give a shout out. My father, Clarence and Bertrand, they hung out like friends. Me, Keith, and Tony, we've been around forever. I'm just telling you about you. I love you too, man. Thank you.
Thank you.
How y'all doing? For y'all don't know me, I'm my name is Keith Banks. I'm married to Tammy. So I got into the Nash family through marriage. And I always call him Uncle Clarence. The first day I see him, and Mr. Burchin always say, hey, young fella. So I didn't have a father figure growing up, so they all like took me in. Him, Uncle Raymond, Uncle Clarence, they all took me in. So we sitting there. So we went fishing one day. He took me fishing, Uncle Clarence, Uncle Raymond, and my dad. So we ride, and like he said, they got this conversation going. I guess it's a Louisiana talk. And they going back and forth to each other, all three of them. They like, and they got this little speech going. So I'm like, Uncle Clarence, what's going on? He said, young fella, don't even worry about these guys out here. They don't know what they're doing. I'm going to teach you how to do this, teach you how to do that. So Uncle Clarence was always the one that I took to. Him and my dad. So Tony, Julie, Kelly, you know, always love you guys. That's why I say you guys in the scripture. You know, the message is stay up, stay prayerful, because God has something else for you guys to do. So like I said, he's here, but he's in a better place. I love you guys. Uncle Clarence, you know I miss him. So like I said, I always had a relationship with him. 14 years that I've known him, that I've came into the Nash family. So I've been with her 14 years. So I beg you to say I'm part of the Nash family.
She did a very good job at doing it. I did as much as I could. thank you, Miss Heather. And all I can say is, it is what it is. But you're doing our best.
Right, we're going to have the final prayers here in church, and then we're going to make our way to Laurel Hill Cemetery, and I believe that we'll lay claim to rest right next to Brother Bertram, right there in that beautiful place. So I want to thank everybody for being here. The Nash family loves to meet them. You can't help but to love the Nash family, and there really is just a depth of faith and kindness here today. I appreciate that. I also want to thank they're just first class. It's like family taking care of family whenever they're in the house, and they are just awesome. And you deserve nothing less than first class. So let us stand and pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey. Mercifully grant and strengthened by it, our brother, we come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our deep affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day, we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Jesus Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Sing and glory. Thank you.